Hello, my name is Jason Johnson, and thank you for watching my videos. I hope you find that they're helpful, and thank you for subscribing to my channel, and thank you for sharing them with others. If you have any questions or feedback, you can leave those in the comments below, and I'll try to get an answer back to you as quick as possible or point you in the right direction. This video is going to be chapter seven, networking concepts. It is a two-part video. This is part two of two, so you will find a link in the description below that will point you to part one of two. So the first video will be, there's a link in the description below. In part two, we're going to talk about basic networking concepts and technologies and how to configure network connectivities between computers or in PCs. So let's take a look at basic networking concepts and technologies. Now, when we're talking about basic, and this is at a basic level, we're going to talk about the networking technology. Some of the terms that you need to know and some of the information is, for example, a MAC address or a machine address code. That's hard-coded onto the network interface card or your NIC card by the manufacturer. The MAC address is a 48-bit hexadecimal representation. So it's base 16 numbering system. So you go from 0 to 9, and then after you get to 9, instead of going to 10, you start off with A, and then you go all the way up to the letter F. So you have base 16, and I've got some videos on binary to decimal conversion. I don't think I have a video yet on hexadecimal, but I will here in the future, so you can check those out on my YouTube channel. And when you write that in there, you have a hexadecimal format. Usually, and this goes beyond the scope of this video, but I'm just going to show you real quick. Usually the manufacturer, and I'm going to make this a little bit smaller here, the manufacturer has the first digits here. They are assigned that by a organization or a governing body. And then the last part here is then assigned locally by the manufacturer. So if you are a company that's manufacturing network interface cards using the Ethernet standard or using a wireless standard, but if you are making network interface cards, you are assigned a hexadecimal numbering system, and then you are given that first part, and then the second part is internal. You can usually take a MAC address on a NIC card, and you can find that card, and you can look it up on the internet, and you can find out who manufactured that card, which is an interesting thing to do. I do that with some of my students sometimes. We will pull NIC cards out, and we will look those up on the internet to see where those were made. But those are hexadecimal numbers that are represented on there. We also have another term that you need to understand, and that's Internet Protocol or IP. When we talk about Internet Protocol, that is assigned by network administrators based on the location within the network. So you can either be assigned manually an IP address or your internet protocol address, or it can be assigned something by like a DHCP server, which is it has a pool of IP numbers that just passes those out. And that's what most local area networks do today, is we have some type of DHCP server that just sends that information out as requested. Now, there's two versions of the IP protocol that we're currently using. We have IPv4 or V4, and if you want to know more about networking, by the way, I've got a whole series on the first course for the CCNA series, the Cisco Academy, the Cisco Networking Academy, and you can check that out on in my playlist. I'll have a link in the description below as well for that, and you can learn about V4 and you can learn about V6, and that's a whole other series and a whole other course with the Cisco Networking Academy. But V4 is a 32-bit IP address. It's written in dotted decimal. We have ran out of 32-bit or the V4 addresses, so we've moved to the V6. It was first finalized in 1995, and a lot of devices, or most devices in 2017, are moving to the V6 version now. It's 128-bit, and it's written in hexadecimal. It has a lot more IP addressing. It just gives us a much deeper pool of IP addressing now to use. But we write that in a hexadecimal. It's 128-bit. IPv format, you're gonna see that written out something like this, you know, 192.168, you know, 200.8. That's probably the one you're more familiar with. The V6 address format is 128-bit. It's written in hexadecimal. And you have these hextets. These are octets. So you have four octets, and an octet being, you know, eight bits. Over here, you're writing these in hextets, and so you have 128 bits, and you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 hextets, and that's 128 bits long. And this is a way to write it in compressed format, and I'm not going to really discuss it in this video here, but you can compress V6 addresses down And you can write them, you know, eliminate hextets of zeros. For example, like these here, we've eliminated 1, 2, and 3, and we've just collapsed those down. Well, we know there's 8 hextets, so we know that there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Then we know that there's 3 sets of zero hextets in there. You can't eliminate hextets, and I'm gonna explain it a little bit here in this video, but I've got other videos in the Networking Academy, the Routing and Switching Networking Academy videos that talk about it even more in depth. But let's say that I had zeros here and here, I can't collapse these and these, because then I wouldn't know where the collapse is. And you can also eliminate leading zeros. You can't eliminate trailing zeros, but I can eliminate leading zeros. So for example, I can write that as 200, and I just know that there's a zero at the front of it, because I know I have 4 characters in that hextet on there. So explains a little bit more in depth than what you're actually going to get in this class, but I know it's important to understand that when you're looking at it. And again, check out my videos on the Routing and Switching, or RNS, for the 5.1 version of the Cisco Networking Academy. There's more videos there that will help you with the V4 and the V6 addressing scheme. Now, when we connect host devices together, they need to have addresses to communicate on the network, and MAC addresses do not change when devices move from one network to another. MAC addresses, and I'm going to say it again, MAC addresses are hard-coded to the NIC card, or your network interface card. You can, what I call, spoof MAC addresses. You can make the network think that it's got a different MAC address, and that's fairly easy to do in the networking world, and that's how you do some kind of MAC man-in-the-middle attacks, and you do some kind of spoofing on a wireless network, some things like that. If you set on a wireless network so only certain MAC addresses can connect, well, you can fool that network into thinking that it's a different MAC address. But as a general rule of information, MAC addresses do not change on that NIC device. IP addresses do change because they're based on software. They're based on where the device is in the network. So, for example, if I have this end device inside this local area network over here, and it's got an address of, you know, 192.168.10.2. Let's just say 10.2, 192.168, and I'm just giving that a V4, and my handwriting is really bad here. We're trying to draw with my mouse. And when I move it over here, my IP addressing scheme over here is 192.168.20.20.something, and then let's say it's going to be 20.2 over here. So and then based upon a /24, and that's way beyond the scope of this video, so I apologize for throwing that in there. But again, I've got videos that show you how to do IP subnetting. And so these are going to be based upon the location. So this device here, if I move it from here over to here, it's going to get a different IP address because it needs to have the IP addressing scheme for this local area network, which is going to be different than the one over here. And there they've got it there, 200.8, and over here 300.8. I used a slightly different one. Okay, so some other points that you need to memorize or need to know is that a V4 address is composed of two parts. The first part identifies the network, and the second part identifies a host on the network. And I've got videos on subnetting, by the way. I have a link in the description on that as well, which helps you with subnetting, helps you figure out, you know, what subnets on which one and all of that. So I've got videos on that. But a computer and router uses the subnet mask to calculate the network portion of the destination IPv4 address. So, and I'm just going to try to explain this in real quick, simple terms. When a network device or an end device starts reading the packet of information and it says, this is your IP address, it starts reading the ones and zeros. And it says, okay, I'm reading 192.168.200.8. And it starts reading these binary numbers. And it says, it reads those. And then it says, what's my subnet mask? And if you notice here, it's got all ones in here. Well, the networking device starts reading across in this binary, and it says 11111 all the way till it gets to a zero. And it says, oh, okay, well, all of those previous bits, all of these previous ones are my network portion of the on there. So it says, okay, so that IP address that I just received, this part here is my network, and everything to the right of that first zero, this first zero and everything to the right of that, everything to the right of the last one, let me say it that way, is my host portion. So all of this over here is my host portion. And that's determined by your subnet mask. So the subnet mask that you put in is going to, you know, be ones, and where the one ends, everything to the right of that is going to be the host portion. I don't expect you to get a full understanding of, you know, networking portion and host portion, but I'm just trying to give you a high level overview here on that. Okay, and then so your network ID, or if I was going to say this is a /24 because we're using 24 bits, 8, 16, 24, and so that's a /24. And so this network, this ID address, I would just hand this to somebody and I would say, here's your address. I have 192.168.200.0/24. And that's based upon the subnet mask of how many bits you have. And then a networking person can then take that and say, okay, I know how many addresses I have in here, and I know how I can divide this up, and then they can do subnetting from there. And again, I've got videos on how to do subnetting and how to understand and read that, and the description is below on those. So, and I apologize for keep saying that, but I just know it's easier to point you to another video than try to explain it here in this one, which I don't have enough time to do. Now, when we have a V6 address and we have to collapse it, here are the rules. I talked about it briefly earlier on a previous slide, but I'm going to just show you again real quick. There's two rules. One is you can omit leading zeros, and rule two is you can omit all zero segments. So on here, I can eliminate the leading zero and write that like this. I can also take a block and say all of the contiguous zero segments. I can eliminate those and write it with just a colon colon. However, I cannot eliminate two non-contiguous zeros segments. So I can't know if I had zero zeros over here, I couldn't eliminate both of them. And I explained that earlier because you need to know where your missing octets are. So for example, on this one here, I can eliminate all my leading zeros and I can write it this way, or I can write it where I compressed it all the way down. And that's an FF02:1. Well, I know that there are still six missing hextets in there. So I could just fill in six. So, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I can fill in 6 hextets of zeros in there, and the computer does the same thing. It just reads that colon colon, and it knows that there's missing, or it's compressed 6 hextets in there. Okay, so transport layer protocols. You need to have a high level understanding of the protocols. Transport layer protocols. There's two of them that we use at that. That's the TCP and the UDP. Transport control protocol. TCP is considered reliable. It ensures that all the data arrives at the destination. That's going to be, for an example, when you're sending a file across the network. And the protocol is going to be used for TCP to send that because it needs to know all the data got there. UDP is does not provide for any reliability. An example for that might be IP. You have an IP phone or you're streaming a video. Let's just say that you connect to a YouTube video and you're streaming, or you're on a digital call or an IP call, internet protocol, telephony call. And the reason that UDP does not provide for reliability is because it's faster. It doesn't take as much data because you don't have a connect, you don't have a back and forth connection. It doesn't require acknowledgments. It does not resend lost data, and it delivers data as it arrives. So it just the information comes in and you hear it. You hear a voice talking on the phone. You watch a video, and sometimes you may be missing data, and that's okay because it might skip a few frames, but we fill in the difference on there. So you might miss a word, and then you can just say to the person, "Hey, can you repeat yourself?" Well, with TCP, it needs to be reliable because we need to know that everything on that web page got delivered to us. We need to know that everything in that file got delivered to us. All of the bits are important. And so those packets get sent and everything gets acknowledged. It resends lost data and it delivers the data in a sequenced order because that data needs to be put back together for a file, for example, or for a web page, needs to be displayed in a certain way. It can't just be jumbled up all over the place. It needs to be formatted properly. And so that's what TCP provides for us versus UDP. And you may say to yourself, why don't just everything get sent use TCP? Well, we still have bandwidth issues and we still try to keep data to a minimum because it does cost money to send that data across a network. So we try to keep that as, at a minimum as much as possible. And we use protocols that help with that. Now, with the transport layer protocols, you do need to have a really good understanding of what we call the well-known ports. And well-known ports are going to be everything from TCP for 2021 for FTP. You might be setting up going to a web server, and that's port 80 or hypertext transport protocol. 443 is the hypertext or HTTP or hypertext transport protocol secure. That's where you encrypt your data for web pages. And so you need to be familiar with this page here or with these port numbers. And if you want to look those up on the internet, if you want to look those up in your material, those are what we call well-known port numbers. And so these are set by the standard, you know, the governing bodies set these, everybody abides by it. And so different, different services use different port numbers. And that's why we know that they're well known. For example, a DHCP server is going to use 67 and 68, for server and client. Okay. So that wraps up this video, and that's part two of chapter 7. We discussed some different things in these, two different videos, both part one and part two. We talked about different types of networks, LANs, MANs, WANs, CANs. We talked about peer-to-peer and client-server. We talked about the TCP/IP model. We talked about CSMA/CD versus CSMA/CA. We talked about coax cables. We talked about the cabling standards, T568A and T568B. We talked about MAC addresses, IP addresses. We talked about the transport layer protocol and then the differences between TCP and UDP, and how one is connection-oriented, one of them is connectionless. All right, so I hope you enjoyed this video. I hope it was helpful for you in your studies. If it was helpful for you, and, you know, I love to hear from students, and I love to hear from people that are watching my videos. So leave a comment below. I'll interact with you if you want that. If not, just, you know, congratulate. I appreciate any feedback. If you think that there's anything that I can do to improve my videos, I do appreciate that feedback as well. So, again, I hope the videos were helpful. Thank you for subscribing. Thank you for sharing my videos with others, and I hope you have a great day.